Welcome to One Question. This is a new program organized by VU-vereniging. The concept is that in 20 minutes, one researcher from Vrije Universiteit Amsterdam will enlighten us in an intriguing topic. After that, we have 10 minutes to ask questions, and we will end at 1 p.m. sharp. Today's speaker is Maaike Morra. You can see her here already. She is a marketing researcher at VU Amsterdam, and she will talk with us about one question, namely, can a no-buy challenge motivate us enough to consume less? So Maaike, without further ado, the floor is yours. Yes.
Let me share my slides. Okay, so my name is Maaike Morra. Indeed, I'm a marketing researcher. My main interests are sustainable consumption. So I'm looking to understand how we can motivate people to to consume more sustainably. Now, I think these new hypes, like the no-buy challenge and the Marie Kondo method, are they really successful in making people consume less? We will try to get an answer to this question in the 20 minutes. Or maybe other hypes like a Black Friday, maybe they even succeed better in making you buy more. So if you look at the pictures, indeed, you know, they focus on discount, making it seems that there's a scarce product, there's not enough available, so you have to move fast. And indeed, in the picture on the right, you see people like crawling on top of one another to get to the products, right? So it seems that this Black Friday is hyper successful in making people buy more. Now, how can we make use of these tendencies to also make people consume sustainably? Now, first, let's delve into like, why do we buy? So first of all, our society is now moving from a production society to a consumption society. So many companies that we interact with, they actually make the most profit in the fact that you will consume more of the products. Yeah. Now this actually taps into a nice tendency of human beings, that we have a growth mindset. We always aim to have like more or newer products. This is not only just on itself, but it's actually motivated by human emotions, such as that we are intend to imitate others. We aim to have like a status, a higher status. And all in all, we have these subconscious motivations that actually motivate us to buy more products. So I put this picture of the elephant and the rider, which is a concept in psychology. Where they want to show the difference between your emotions, which is the elephant, and the rider, which is your conscious brain. So in the end, you have only a small capacity to direct your behavior into a different pathway as your emotions. Your emotions motivate you to behave in a certain way, while your conscious brain might, you know, see ahead and might change the direction a little bit. Now, these subconscious emotions, they are grounded in evolutionary biases. So these are five biases, I just named five of them, that actually motivate much of our behavior. So this is the elephant as we speak, right? This is not our like conscious brain where we deliberately and rationally make choices, but we tend to follow these five biases. So the first one is that you are short-sighted. You tend to focus on the now. It's really hard as a person to look ahead and to see, okay, what I do right now will affect my behavior or the world in 20 years from now. So you tend to really focus on what is happening now and whether you can see your consequences immediately. Now, a second evolutionary bias is that you mainly look out for your self-interest. Most people, they try to be kind to themselves, right? So you want to have like a good life, you want to enjoy yourself. So your own pleasure comes first. Now, we can already see that these two biases are opposed to what most sustainable behavior or these hypes like a no-buy challenge actually entail, right? They aim for you to not be short-sighted, to look ahead, to see what your behavior does in the future, also to postpone your own desires, right? So let's move on to the third evolutionary bias. Most people are motivated for relative status instead of absolute status. Now, what is the consequence of this? Is that actually you will never have enough because there will always be people that have more. Now, we can see this already in this competition between Elon Musk and other rich people that try, you know, even to have more, even though they have like so much already. So this means that, you know, if you aim for relative status, then of course, you know, you will buy more and more and more. It's really going to be really hard to not buy, to make the decision to stop buying. Now we will also go into this, how we can use relative status to make people be motivated to buy sustainably. Fourth, there's a tendency to copy others. So if you see a lot of people walking around with a certain cup, you might also want to have this cup. And this doesn't go rationally. It's not that you see this cup and you say, oh, I also want it. But if you come across it in the store, you just say, oh, I remember. And it immediately gets this automatic impulse in buying that cup. Now, again, this evolutionary bias, it can be used for the better as well. So it is used a lot in non-sustainable consumption, but it might also be used for the better. Now, fifth, is a proneness to disregard impalpable concerns. So impalpable concerns are those that you cannot immediately sense or see with your senses. Yeah, so it might be that, for instance, if you're in a shop, in a supermarket, and you're able to choose between like a fish that is sustainably caught or a fish that is not sustainably caught, then it's really hard for you as a consumer to immediately see the difference between those two fishes. Yeah, so your proneness is to disregard the thing that you cannot see. You cannot really see the difference between the fish. You don't see the damage that it has done if it is unsustainably caught in the sea. Now, this is, of course, also really difficult to deal with. Now, how do we can use these five evolutionary biases for the better? We will go into that right now. Also, if you have questions, you can always interrupt. Okay, so here are two initiatives that are really focused on sustainable consumption. So one is the no-buy challenge, which is also in the title, the main question of this lunch talk. So it's really a challenge for people to not buy anything. Sometimes they only focus on one category. Most of the time, it's not buying anything for a certain period of time. Now, another initiative is to follow this RRR, like refuse, reduce, reuse. And then others also added recycle, repair, and rot. Now, both of these challenges, they actually are countered to your evolutionary biases. Because the RRR actually requires you to look ahead, to postpone your immediate desires. The no-buy challenge, similarly. So how can we make use of these evolutionary biases to still, you know, make sure that people go around these biases and do as they are asked to do, to not buy certain products or maybe, you know, to refuse or to reduce certain consumption. Now, I think the question that we should ask ourselves as well, like, is there something like sustainable consumption? So when is consumption sustainable? So I think consumption can be sustainable if it is mindful. So mindful means that you do not buy the things you don't need. You do not buy things just mainly to improve your status. And you do not buy, oh, sorry, I have to look it up because... and you do not buy repetitive products. So things that you buy over and over again and are thrown away after they've been used. Now, another stream in this sustainable consumption atmosphere is minimalism. So minimalism is really focusing on not buying many products, but if you buy something, then it's sustainable and you can it can last for a very long time. Now, I think sustainable consumption most of the time, if you can talk, say something is sustainable, then most of the time you have to spend more effort and you have to postpone your desires. Now, I think these problems or these efforts and the postponing the desires actually make sustainable consumption something that is hard to do, right? So you have to keep something from yourself in order to have like sustainable consumption. Now, I think the main problem with this is that the people who are able to do this sustainable consumption, they might have like this idea of moral superiority, right? Being better than others, because you are able to spend this extra effort and you are able to postpone your desires. And this is actually a problem that has been encountered a lot with sustainability, is that when you ask people to behave sustainably, it might be that they actually become a little bit irritated or annoyed by this moral being better than others, right? So here there's an example of a blog that somebody asked the question on how this eco-community became so intolerant and competitive. Now, I think this is definitely a problem. And what I've seen in, so I also give a course on sustainable innovations, the ones that are successful, they tend not to focus on the sustainability aspect, but on other aspects. So as an example, for instance, Lowland the Beer, I think maybe some of you have come across in supermarkets, they actually do not focus on the sustainable part of their product, but they focus on the enjoyment of their product. Also, Tony Chocoloni is an example of like a sustainable brand that does not focus, it doesn't make the sustainability the prime essence of their products. Now, then next to this sustainability and sustainable consumption, whether it's possible or not, then we assume, of course, that everybody knows what is sustainable. But is this really true? So, you know, if we look at avocados, for instance, everybody knows they're very healthy. They don't contain meat, so it must be more sustainable than other choices. However, still, there's a lot of water being used by producing avocados. Yeah, so for instance, on the right, you see a picture of Mexico. So in Mexico is the world producer of avocados, and there's a lot of drought problems in Mexico. So this is a balance. So do we want to inform consumers to make sensible choices? And then, of course, we come into the issue that it becomes really difficult to make the sustainable choices. We did some research on sustainable meals. And what we found out is that, for instance, a simple thing that you buy, like bananas, it really depends on the week you buy it in, whether it's sustainable or not. So some bananas, if the supermarkets ran out of bananas and they think consumers would like them, then they just fly them in. So it might be that those bananas are much less sustainable than the ones in the week before. So, and on top of that, even supermarkets, most of them, they don't know where the products are coming from. So it's really hard for a producer, it's hard to know what is sustainable, and for a consumer, it becomes really almost impossible to know what is sustainable. Now, of course, with respect to food, it's very clear that meat is very unsustainable because there's a lot of water being needed to produce meat. And also, things that needs to be like are not seasonal, right? So if you buy something out of season, strawberries in the mid of January, those are probably not sustainable. Now, I think this information paradox, it also requires us to look a little bit more with a soft lens to the consumer's behavior. Because I think if people are aware of what is sustainable and what is not, it's definitely a lot of them will be more tempted to behave that way. But then again, you know, how much information does a consumer really want to have, right? sometimes there's a little bit of an overload with all the information. Now, how do people persuade others in buying certain products? Now, one thing is, for instance, that people like those who like them. And actually, I had a different picture, but the idea is that if you like others, you will try to behave similarly. Now, the second one is whether people repay in kind. So if you pay, if you give something away, you're more likely to receive a similar gift back to you. People also follow the lead of similar others. So let's say, you know, they identify themselves with a certain group in society. If those people, they show a certain behavior, they're more likely to copy that. People also align with clear commitments. So you can imagine that a company that is very sustainable, or at least they say so, but then the transportation is very unsustainable, then, you know, as consumer, you think, okay, this doesn't really add up. Now, I think one example is, for instance, Peter Potts. This is a supermarket that actually wants to do without any wrap. So there's no wrappers anymore. Everything is in bottles. And they bring it to you in a CO2 neutral way. Another supermarket that you can think of is Picnic, which also tries to do this. So I think a lot of companies now, they make more and more efforts to show their commitment to the sustainability, which actually can convince consumers to also align with these commitments. Now, another thing that persuades people to consume in a certain way is that people defer to experts. So if you have a certain expertise in a certain area, you should also show it, right? So if a company really knows better about a certain issue, so for instance, is water being used?
Yeah, Maaike, I jump in really quick. You have 2 minutes left.
Okay, good. Yeah, I'm almost done. So, expertise is definitely something that people are likely to follow. Now, last persuasion science is that people, they want usually more of what they can have less of. So scarcity is really a motivation to buy more. We already saw that with the Black Friday discounts, where you have like these billboards, like, you know, you have to go now, it's only 50% a discount, so be fast, because otherwise this will be run out. Now, you can also use this in a different way. So for instance, Umeco is a brand that actually really focuses on the exclusivity of their materials. So another thing that you can think of is Tesla, which also focuses on the exclusivity, on the rareness, the special part of their sustainable products. Now, the shopping season has arrived. So I think most of you have been, you know, probably struggling also with this, these two contradictions, right? On the one hand, we would like to be more sustainable, maybe like do a no-buy challenge, have less products in the house. But then on the other hand, you're really motivated to buy a lot, and you're primed everywhere in the shops and also online to buy more products. So I would like to to stress, think about these evolutionary biases, because they are actually primed, and they prime you all the time to buy more. So think about the different ways to spend your holiday season, and maybe, you know, shop some sustainable products or maybe experiences for your loved ones. Yeah.
Thank you so much, Maaike, for your 20-minute lecture. I learned a lot. I think there are a couple of people here who don't speak Dutch, so I think we'll continue to go on in English. We now have 10 minutes for questions. Is there anybody here who listened to Maaike's lecture and says, well, I have a question, please go ahead. You can just unmute yourself and start asking your questions.
No questions?
Well, perhaps, is there, thank you for your lecture. I tried to follow this, but I'm also working, so. Sorry.
Yeah, don't worry.
Is there a difference between generations, or, you know, groups of and how old and how it affects the choices, and did you really look into it in your investigation?
Yes, yeah, so indeed, we did a research on this sustainable meals, right? So how people eat. And we do see that millennials are more, they would like to be more sustainable. So we do say there's really a theme among millennials to eat sustainably, to behave more sustainably, to, you know, to reuse, to be part of the circular economy. However, what we also see is among these millennials is that they have like this lack of information. So they're not always, even though they would like to make the sustainable choices, they're not always capable of making sustainable choices. Now with the older generations, it's actually less likely that they will both would like to behave sustainably and also act sustainably. But we do as a positive note, so we try to see how what kind of information we had to give people to make them eat more sustainably. And what really helped was to focus on the immediate personal benefits, so the health, and to give them recipes. So we just gave them like clear recipes, just a choice like replace your chicken by this or replace your beef by chicken to make it like a little bit more sustainable. And we saw that those who got this information, they actually did eat more sustainably in 2 weeks later after the experiment.
Okay. And also with no regards of generation.
Yes.
Okay. That's nice.
Yeah. There was in the wider population. Yeah.
Okay. Okay. Yeah. Thank you.
Do you also have a practical hint on how you can let people know what these biases are? If you say that if people would know these biases, then they would know how to resist them. But how can you let people know what these biases are, for example, in the supermarket?
Yeah, so in the supermarket, there's so many biases at hand there. So I only mentioned a few of them, but, you know, they of course are, you know, they spend like years and years and years to optimize the way how you go through the supermarket and buy enough products. So one thing is, for instance, that you balance your what you buy. So if you first buy some healthy stuff, then you allow yourself to buy something unhealthy. But this doesn't only refer to healthy, so that's why the vegetable and the fruits are always in the beginning, right? But it also accounts for sustainable products. So if you first bought something sustainable, then maybe at some point you say, okay, you know, now I did all these sustainable good actions, now I'm allowed to buy this, you know, cheaper meats in bulk. So this, of course, so even I, when I read a lot about these biases, even I, in the supermarkets, I sometimes see that I'm also trapped in these motivations. So it's really hard to tell people, okay, just mind yourself, you know, that your tendency is to, if you did something good, that you're going to do something bad, right, in terms of sustainability or in terms of health. But will it really help people to not do that? I think that's going to be, it's a really big challenge. They, you know, the biases are very powerful and the companies are very smart in how to direct the attention towards the biases. So I think what is more successful probably is that if the sustainable products become as good as the conventional products in making use of these biases.
Ja, mag ik wat vragen?
Ja, tuurlijk.
I can't use my camera.
Oh yeah, don't worry.
It's broken.
Yeah.
So, what I didn't hear is the cost. People mm-hmm. like to buy cheap things.
Yeah.
First of all. You didn't mention that in the tendencies.
Yeah, so I think this is indeed the biggest motivation to not buy sustainably is the price consideration. So what we see from research is that people, they tend, if you ask them, they say like, yeah, I really want to buy sustainably, but then in fact, in the shop, they do not. They opt for the more cheaper product.
Yeah.
So I think this is something, I mean, in my opinion, it should be organized at a higher level, at the society level, or the government level, because indeed, you know, the cost, is not the real cost that you pay, right? I mean, there's a lot of like resources being used that are not charged at all to the consumer. So I think no producer will do this voluntarily, except for the sustainable consumers. But then you also see that the prices are much, much higher. So I think, well, that slide I left out because we focus so much on the consumer. But I think the solution is not with the consumer, but it is with the producer. So actually, the companies should change their behavior. And if they do not do that voluntarily, then the government should take these unpopular decisions to make them, you know, to also make them charge the cost of the ecological damage that they make. But I mean, this is my ideal future, and I don't, you know, I know that it's probably really hard to attain.
Thank you. I'll send a note to the new cabinet. Thank you.
Yeah, no problem.
Can I also ask a question?
Yes, sure.
Mag ik hem in het Nederlands stellen? Volgens mij is iedereen...
Mag ook in
het
Nederlands,
in het gezelschap. Ja. Ik ben benieuwd, want je zei als je een, nou, bijvoorbeeld een biologische vis en een niet-biologische naast elkaar in de supermarkt ziet en je ziet het verschil niet in hoeveel schade de ene vis heeft gekost om hier te komen ten opzichte van de andere. Als je dat op de verpakking wel duidelijk zou maken, net als dat bij pakjes sigaretten niet gebeurt, of dat dan uit zou maken.
Nou, je ziet bij gezondheid dat het heel goed werkt. Ze hebben bijvoorbeeld in Engeland hebben ze zo'n stoplichtsysteem, waarbij zeg maar het zout en het vet en het suiker, dat wordt dan allemaal afgewogen of je dan een rood beeld krijgt, een rode stip of een groene stip of oranje. Ons idee was inderdaad om dat eerst ook te doen met duurzaamheid. En we hebben daarvoor gepraat met mensen van Questionmark, die eigenlijk over alle producten die worden verkocht in de supermarkt proberen een label te maken over hoe duurzaam het is. En het bleek dat het ontzettend moeilijk was. Omdat bijvoorbeeld melk, welke melk is nou duurzamer dan andere melk? Hoe kun je dat bepalen? Want soms komen ze zelfs uit dezelfde fabriek, zeg maar. Hè? Dus het is heel moeilijk om te herleiden. Waar komt het product nou precies vandaan en hoe duurzaam is dat dan geproduceerd? En ook bijvoorbeeld die bananen. En die bananen kunnen de ene week, hetzelfde product kan de ene week toch minder duurzaam zijn dan de andere week.
Ja, en toch, en ik snap dat het ingewikkeld is, zou ik er dus wel, als ik zie dat het deze week niet duurzaam is, minder geneigd zijn het te kopen.
Ja.
Ja. Maar goed, dan is het al wel naar Nederland gehaald, dus dan is het wel te laat. Maar dat zou, denk ik, uit kunnen maken.
Ja, dat is, dan zou de supermarkt... Kijk, er zijn al onderzoeken over geweest. Nou, en wat sowieso in België een keer is gedaan en wat heel succesvol was, was dat eigenlijk alle lokale, eigenlijk de seasonal products, dus van het seizoen, dus alle groenten van het seizoen, dat ze die helemaal in het midden van de zaal, zeg maar, lieten zien. En daar eigenlijk de aandacht op vestigden. Dus verder daar niet veel bij zeggen, maar behalve dat het dus uit seizoen komt, seizoensproducten. En dat maakt natuurlijk heel veel uit. Dus ik kan me voorstellen dat zoiets ook bij het vis, je moet op een of andere manier moet je duidelijk maken aan mensen dat dat dan de betere optie is. En ik denk alleen maar een merkje, MSC, is denk ik toch te weinig om voor veel mensen die hele die prijsimpuls, hè, want het is natuurlijk veel duurder, dus je moet wel bereid zijn om dan dat meer, die meerprijs te betalen op dat moment. Ja.
All right. We are at the end of this one question event. It is almost 1 p.m. and we said we would end at 1 p.m. sharp. So we're gonna wrap it up. Maaike, thank you so much for joining us and for enlightening us in this very interesting topic. I learned a lot. I hope the others did as well. For now, we are wrapping up and we will hope to meet you all again next year. Then we'll continue to be hosting this one question events. Thank you all for being here and I hope you all have a great day. So you can now leave this meeting. Goodbye.
Okay, thank you.